So, good evening once again. My name is Mike Kiley-Zufelt. I am the Regional Preparedness Manager for the Eastern Pennsylvania Region of the American Red Cross. I've been working with the Red Cross now for 15 years. Mm-hmm. I am a huge disaster geek. I have loved disasters since I was about this big. You guys are probably too young to remember, but I've probably seen the original Poseidon Adventure movie about 274 times or so. Oh good, we have more people. Yay. A little more people, come on in. We were just getting started. I was just introducing myself. I'm Mike Kiley-Zufelt with the Eastern Pennsylvania Region of the Red Cross. I'm the Preparedness Manager for our region, and I'm responsible for making sure, usually supporting our disaster program specialists, whose job it is to make sure that all of our disaster-related services, whether they be preparedness education or events or responding to disasters or helping people who've been affected by disasters recover, their job to make sure all that stuff happens. Then I'm one of the people who's in a support role to provide them the resources that they need in order to do their job. So I was just talking about the fact that I love this stuff, talking about disasters and educating people about disasters. I'm a huge disaster geek, love watching disaster movies. You guys may remember the original Poseidon Adventure. I probably saw that about 274 times. Just all things disaster, I'm very, very interested in. I grew up in a firefighter household. Both of my grandfathers were volunteer firefighters. My dad was a volunteer firefighter. His brother was a volunteer firefighter. My mom's brother was a volunteer firefighter. My grandmother on my mom's side, my mom, my sister, a couple of my cousins all involved with the Ladies Auxiliary for the same volunteer fire company. How I did not become a volunteer firefighter, I'm sure that my therapist will uncover at some point in my life. But as you can see from the work that I do for the Red Cross, the nut didn't fall that far from the tree. So what I wanted to go over tonight was just the basics that we recommend for folks as far as being prepared to deal with emergency events like disasters. And to get started, I just wanted to ask a couple of questions of you guys. And since we're a small group, I don't want to embarrass anybody by making you say anything. But so does anybody have a disaster kit? Does anybody have supplies that they have set aside in order to help in a disaster situation? That's okay. Large percentage of the population do not. I think it's only the latest stat for, I think it was around the Philadelphia area, was United Way did a survey and it was like 12% or something of the people actually had some supplies set aside. How about a plan in case you or your family are affected by a disaster of any kind? No? Okay. Also, not surprising. Can anybody tell me what shelter in place means?
Finding a safe place to...
Okay, pretty close. Hopefully, by the end of our time together here, you will at least have a good idea about how to put together a disaster supply kit and what should be included in your kit. Know the basics of putting together a plan on what to do, where to go, who you need to be in touch with, those types of things. And know what shelter in place means and the importance of that in terms of disasters and responding to that. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about your Red Cross, which is the Eastern Pennsylvania region of the Red Cross, the three actions for being prepared that we discuss and recommend to folks, and then give you a little bit of contact information in case you have any follow-up questions or need additional information. So who are we at the Red Cross? We are an organization that prevents and alleviates human suffering in the face of emergencies by mobilizing the power of our volunteers and the generosity of our donors. That pretty much is, in a quick little paragraph statement, exactly who we are as an organization. A lot of people, when they think of the Red Cross, they think of two things. Well, let me ask you, when you think of the Red Cross, what do you think of? Blood, okay? And then the other one?
Disaster relief.
Disaster, we refer to it as blood and blankets, is typically what people think of when they talk about the Red Cross. So, just a little bit more information about us. We are a non-governmental, nonprofit organization. We have, actually, this number has dropped. I forgot to update this slide when I was working on this morning. I think we're down to around 500 regions now in the United States. We still have a lot of volunteers, about 500,000 folks who work with us. That makes up 93% of the workforce of the American Red Cross is all volunteers. About 35,000 paid staff. I am actually fortunate enough to be one of those paid staff. As I said, I've been working for the Red Cross for 15 years. We respond to over 70,000 disasters here in the United States in an average year, and more than 15 million people take some sort of class or get some kind of education or materials from the Red Cross that can in some way be a life-saving situation, whether it's a disaster education course like this one, or a CPR class, or lifeguarding, or one of our youth programs. We do a lot of education here and training in the United States. Here in Eastern Pennsylvania, welcome. We have about 1,700 volunteers who work just in our emergency services department. Emergency services, they're the folks who get the call at 2 o'clock in the morning that somebody has experienced a fire. They go out, provide assistance for those clients, open up a casework for them, get them some financial assistance, a place to stay if they need that, help to work with them to get replacement clothes and any other needs that they may have. We are a 24/7, 365 organization. Disasters don't take holidays, so neither do we. In addition to being 24-hour, 7-day-a-week, 365-day-a-year organization here in Eastern Pennsylvania, we also have one of only 6 call centers in the United States that are staffed 24 hours a day. It used to be we were one of, I think there was only one other one in the entire country not too long ago. And it was a decision that our organization here in Southeastern PA had made probably close to 2 decades ago now, that if somebody needed the Red Cross here in Southeastern Pennsylvania, when they dialed that phone number to talk to the Red Cross, to request Red Cross assistance, they needed to talk to somebody who was affiliated with the Red Cross. So we started staffing our phones 24 hours a day, so that when you called, no matter what time it was, there was always a Red Cross person answering the phone to be able to get you the help that you needed, start casework, whatever needed to be done. We used that model and convinced the National Red Cross, when they were trying to convince us to stop doing that and that it would save money if we went to an answering service and did it that way. The call would come to the answering service would call the person who was on call for dispatching disasters at night when we were closed, and then they would make sure that the people went out and provided the casework. We did a 6-month case study of our communication center and actually found out that it was less expensive for us to staff the phones 24 hours a day, and it helped the clients to feel better about their interactions with the Red Cross. So the National Red Cross went over and now has these call centers in 6 places on the United States. So say a smaller chapter in Wyoming, they close their offices at 5 o'clock, they flip their phones over and it goes to one of the call centers across the United States. Call comes in at 2 o'clock in the morning. What is Wyoming? I don't know if they're central or western time. Pardon my lapse of geography knowledge there. Call goes in there, it goes to one of the call centers. The agent at the call center has a list of who is on call in terms of responding for Wyoming that night. They tell the person, hey, you know, Mrs. Jones, who's had a fire, Stan is on call tonight. I'm gonna give him a call. He'll touch base with you, and you guys can make arrangements when he can come over and start the casework for you. So it's a direct communication that's with people right from the get-go when they need the Red Cross, rather than having a, you know, kind of impersonal answering service as it go between there. So we're pretty proud of that, that the entire nation is now practicing the model that we started here in southeastern Pennsylvania. So last year, FY16, we are July 1 to June 30 fiscal year. So for fiscal year 16, we responded to over 1,200 disasters, assisted over 4,500 people as a result of those, and we also reached over 1.5 million people through our education efforts just here in eastern Pennsylvania in our latest fiscal year. So the education side of things, we're not just blood and blankets, we also do a lot of education programs. Disaster preparedness is just one of those areas. And when we talk about disaster preparedness, there are three actions that we recommend that people take in order to better ready themselves to deal with a disaster situation. And even though you've got the little 1, 2, 3s up here on the screen next to each of those, it's not like a checklist. So you're not doing number one and then moving on to number two and then moving on to number three. These are three actions that are taken in conjunction with each other. So I think that can be a little bit confusing, so I want to make sure that, folks understand that. So the first thing that we talk about with folks is the importance of getting a kit. Don't kill yourself to write all this stuff down, because everybody's going to get a handout at the end. I don't give them out during, because then paper's rattling stuff and it becomes distracting, and besides, they should pay attention to me, not the paper in front of them. So getting a kit, what are the items that we recommend that people have in terms of two possible situations? Okay. The first one is you have to evacuate your home because of a large-scale disaster event. The flooding, for example, that just happened in Louisiana, the wildfires that we've been dealing with recently in California, anything like that, hurricanes, situations like that. So you have to leave your home because of that disaster situation. What are the things that you want to make sure that you are taking with you when that happens that are going to help you to get through that situation as close to normal as possible? Okay, so that's one. The other is, if you have to stay at home because of a disaster event. Any of you folks live here in this area in 1996? Okay. Remember January of 1996? The ice and snowstorm that we had. Within like 24 hours, there were 28 inches of snow dumped on this region. Schools were closed for a week. Stores were closed for a number of days at the beginning of that week. If you hadn't heeded the warnings that were coming up and gone out and stocked up on supplies, or you weren't one of those people who regularly, you know, had a disaster supply kit or something like that, and you didn't do it before this storm hit, you were at the mercy of your neighbors as far as food and other things were concerned, because not only could you not get anywhere because the roads were still just so congested with the snow and everything, but even if you could go anywhere, most of the stores didn't open for 2 or 3 days because the employees couldn't get to them. Or if you could get to the store, you actually couldn't get to the store because there was too much snow in front of the door and then people couldn't actually get in there. So thinking about that situation. So there's two different kits really that we talk about. One is a go kit and one is your at-home supplies. Sometimes people will refer to it as your shelter-in-place supplies. I think that's kind of misusing shelter-in-place, but I'm a stickler and for details and things like that, and I'll get into a little bit more about why that is. So as we're discussing this kit, some of these things are going to be for at home, some of these things are going to be for go, and some of them are going to be for both, and I'll do my best to make clear what we're talking about in each of those situations. So what are the things that you want to have in a supply kit, whether it's one you're going to take with you or one that you have at home? I was working very early on in my time with the Red Cross when I did a lot more youth education than I do now. It's probably a fourth grade class that I was with, And we have been talking about the importance of having a kit and the stuff that you needed in the kit and why you would need the kit and everything. And one of the students raises her hand. And I said, yes, what is it? I can't remember what her name is at this point, but she's like, so basically what you're saying is we need to think about this as if we were going camping for 3 days and our tent was gonna be there, but we have to bring everything else with us. I was like, you know what? That's a pretty good way to think about it. So we're going to assume that if you have to evacuate, there's gonna be some sort of shelter available for you at some point down the road, whether that's at a Red Cross shelter or at somebody else's house or in some other location. But other stuff you wanna make sure that you've got with you. So that's kind of how I frame what do you think about or what are the things that you need in order to get through the situation. So what do you think are some of those items that you would want in that situation?
First aid kit.
So a first aid kit, okay.
Document.
Documents, copies of important documents, excellent.
What else?
Water.
Batteries.
Batteries.
Toiletries and toothbrush.
Toiletries, personal hygiene items. Anything else?
Your own medicine.
Medications.
Clothes.
Clothes, change of clothes. All right, anything else that's a big one? Think of? Food is the only one that I would like really throw in there that's important that you guys didn't mention. So let's see what our list says up here. So water, absolutely, water is very, very important. For your at-home supplies, we recommend that you have at least 3 gallons of water per person in your household because we want 3 days worth of supplies minimum. So it's a gallon of per person per day. So 3 gallons per person minimum for your household supplies. Now for your grab-and-go supplies, even though you will sometimes see people talking about, oh, you need a gallon per person and 3 days in your go supplies, I am much more realist than that, okay? If my 75-year-old dad, who just had valve replacement surgery, had to evacuate his home with my 71-year-old mom, who has arthritis problems, they're not carrying 3 gallons of water apiece when they evacuate the house. That's just not reality. So what we recommend is that you throw a couple of bottles of water, enough that you think will last you from wherever you are to wherever you're going to go in that situation. And we'll make the, I know it's sometimes dangerous, but we're gonna make the assumption that when you get wherever it is that you're going, that there's gonna be food and water available there, so you don't have to take all of it with you, okay? The food and a manual can opener, so non-perishable food items, things that have a long shelf life, and if they are canned, make sure you have a manual can opener to be able to get into them. And for goodness sake, make sure that it's stuff that people in the house are actually gonna eat. Doesn't do any good to go to ShopRite for the can sale and get 50 cans of Brussels sprouts if nobody likes Brussels sprouts. Although in a disaster, people are probably gonna eat Brussels sprouts if they have to, but better you have stuff that people actually like to eat and make it a little bit better of a situation for them as far as the food is concerned. Flashlight and extra batteries. What about candles? That was a big one in my house when I was a kid, even though I was a firefighter's son. We had lots of candles around in case the power went out. We say no to the candles. Anything that's an open flame is a potential fire hazard. We don't want people to try and keep themselves safe and put themselves in danger at the same time. So we want to stick with flashlights, camping lanterns that are battery operated, those battery operated candles, those are great, but anything that's an open flame, we're gonna stay away from. And again, making sure you've got those extra batteries. Battery powered radio and also extra batteries for that. Why a battery powered radio? In case the power goes out. You're still gonna need to get information. So you wanna have a battery powered radio so you continue to get information even if the power's not working. First aid kit, we mentioned. Prescription and non-prescription medications. Whoops, I'm gonna go back to this one for just a second here. So with the water, the food, the batteries, items in a first aid kit, and medications, aside from the fact that those are things that are going to help you in a disaster situation, what do they also have in common? Something else that all of those things have. I don't know.
Shelf life.
Shelf life, yeah. I was just looking at the bottles to see if there was. They all have an expiration date. They're not good indefinitely. So we recommend that every 6 months, you go into your kit and you check the contents of your kit that have expiration dates on it. And if it's getting close to that expiration, you swap it out. When I was taking a prescription medication, I used to be on prescription Zantac, back when you couldn't get that over the counter. You had to get it through prescription. And what I would do is, I would had to do a mail order because of my insurance company. So every time the new shipment would come in, I would take the stuff out of my disaster kit, put that in the cabinet so that it was the first stuff that I took, and then put the new stuff into the kit so that I was always rotating my stock and I always had fresh medications in there. I'm a little, you know, OCD when it comes to that sort of stuff. Other folks, if you just want to check it every 6 months, that should be sufficient to make sure that you're doing okay with anything that has an expiration date on it. Other things we talk about, the tools really for your go kit. Oh, and let me go back here to this one. So water, as I said, just a couple bottles of water for a go kit, 3 gallons per person in your at-home supplies. Food, again, just a couple little things to get you through to wherever you're going. We recommend 2,000 calories a day for 3 days for each person in the family for your at-home kit. You will see some, and that's minimum, you'll see a lot of stuff now has kind of shifted over and they're looking at a little bit more long-term at-home stuff ever since the avian flu situation that we were facing and people started thinking about, wow, it may not just be a snowstorm for a couple days, it may be a viral pandemic of some kind and we may be at home or recommended not to be going out into public places for a longer period of time. So you will see anything from 3 days to 2 weeks now as far as recommended supplies at home. We say minimum of 3 days, okay? Can't hurt to have more than that. Flashlights and extra batteries, they're gonna be both at home and in your go kit. Same thing with the radio, same thing with the first aid kit and the prescription and non-prescription medications as well. So all of that stuff is a both at home and go kit. Tools, not so necessary at your at-home kit, but definitely at least like a multi-purpose tool kind of thing, a Leatherman tool in your go kit. I actually have a set of tools in my at-home kit because as OCD as I am about some things, I'm not that way about tools. And typically what will happen at my house is I'll go and use a screwdriver for something, take it out of the toolbox downstairs in the basement, go use it wherever I use it, and then whichever one of the what I call the in-here drawers that is closest, which I have several of around the house, that's where the screwdriver ends up back in. So if I go looking for that screwdriver again, it may take me a little while to find it. So I have a basic set of tools in my at-home kit that I have disciplined myself not to touch so that if I need something, I know that it is there in an emergency situation. Clothing and bedding, obviously you're gonna have that stuff around the house. If you can, pack it in your go supplies and it won't be challenging to be able to transport that stuff, then a change of clothes and a change of bedding. If you're going to a shelter that the Red Cross opens, it's a pretty basic situation, okay? Did you, in any of your experience with the education you were doing in India, actually see any shelters that were open or do anything like that?
We do, but shelters are not that big. But whenever there is a big disaster, like tsunami or something mm-hmm. happens, then there are Red Cross and other shelters. They open like a tent. They do mm-hmm. tents and it's it is a little higher from the ground.
So up at a higher yeah. elevation?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and if you've ever been in one of them, it's not the higher regency, okay? When you get in there, it's very basic stuff. You get a cot, you get a blanket, you get a pillow, You get three decent but fairly basic meals during the course of the day. So if you're able to bring your own bedding with you to help supplement what you're experiencing there at the shelter, then you know, that's gonna help you get through that situation. Same thing with the clothing, because in addition to like being in survival mode when we're thinking about this stuff, you also wanna think about your mental health in a situation like this, because it's not just a physically disruptive situation that's going on when we're dealing with a disaster. It can be really psychologically traumatizing for folks as well. And the more we can do to make the situation as normal as possible, to normalize it as much as we can, then the better we're gonna be. And the more that we can do to make ourselves comfortable, not only physically, but from a mental health perspective as well, the better it is.
So,
yeah, I was gonna actually talk about that kind of stuff. But as far as the clothing is concerned, you have to evacuate your home because you know, it's the second coming of Sandy or whatever. It's raining, already started raining, you have to evacuate your home, you get to a shelter, you get assigned to your cot and everything. You can go into your bag and pull out a dry set of clothes to put on. That is going to help you deal with that situation a little bit better. So it's not just the very practical things that we're looking at, it's the mental health side of things as well. Cash and coins may not be necessary. We're not gonna ask you for anything at the Red Cross. All of our disaster services are free of charge, but may be helpful because, you know, most of our shelters here in the United States are set up in schools, usually high schools is where we set up our shelters. And you know, something as simple as, you know, when I was growing up, I loved orange Fanta soda. It was like one of my favorite things in the whole world. We're probably not gonna be serving orange Fanta at the shelter, you know, from the Red Cross perspective, but a lot of schools have vending machines in them. If the power's working, you know, you or, you know, your five-year-old is looking over there going, oh, I really want an orange Fanta, and is driving you absolutely nuts about it, you got some cash or coins on you, you can alleviate that situation either for you or for them. And again, it helps to make for a better situation. Sanitary supplies, as you were talking about, personal hygiene items. And again, it's not just a practical situation. Many times we will have those things available for people in shelters, but you know, we're creatures of habit alive. So like my toothpaste is the toothpaste that I like. I've been buying the same toothpaste for I don't even know how many years. And I've had a situation where I've gone on a business trip or gone on vacation and forgot my toothpaste. And it's been too late to go out to the store. So I dial down to the front desk and they bring up some toothpaste and it's not mine. And you know, it's not like it ruins my vacation or anything, but I'm just not in as good a mood as I would be if I got to use my toothpaste that night. You know, same thing with things like shampoo and soap and all those. You know, there's a reason we call them personal hygiene items. It's because we will personalize that. So it's not just practical, but also helps for that mental health wellness as well. When we're talking about stuff like that.
Yeah. Yes. You said high schools. They don't think we have a lot of showers, like baby wipes or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely an idea, a good thing to have. There's two reasons why we typically go to high schools. One is that high schools tend to have, are more likely to have single-use gymnasiums. They're not a multi-purpose room, they're just a gymnasium. So we can set up cots in the gymnasium, and then they also have a separate cafeteria where we can serve food in that area as well. And depending upon what kind of agreement we reached with the school, we may be able to utilize the locker room facilities and allow people to be able to have showers in the schools as well. And again, more likely we're going to find those in high schools than in elementary schools. And a lot of the elementary schools, especially in this area, have a single, what are they, it's like the gymatorium. So it's like, not only is it the gym, but it's also the cafeteria and it's the auditorium where they do assemblies. It's one multi-purpose room, so that would not work very well for us in terms of utilizing it for a larger population. Copies of important documents, as you talked about, insurance policies, leases, deeds, credit card information, all that sort of stuff. It's good to have a copy of those, not your originals, a copy of those important documents sealed in a, like a Ziploc bag in your go kit, okay? Contact information and a map. Contact information for any body, any resource, any place that is important to you in your day-to-day life. So making sure that you know how to get in contact with the people, resources, and places that are important to you for you to be able to function normally. You know, family members, friends, doctors, pharmacies, houses of worship, any one of those is something you would probably want to be remain connected to in that situation, and how best to go about connecting with them. And the reason that it's important to write it down is in some emergency situations, this stuff just doesn't work correctly. It gets disrupted, and you know, I don't know about you guys, but I am a complete and utter slave to this as far as information is concerned. Okay? When I was a kid, I could dial my home phone number, my grandparents' phone number, the firehouse phone number, and probably at least a dozen of my friends' phone numbers from memory because I was calling them all the time. I'm lucky I can remember my own phone number now because I don't dial anymore. I open this thing up and I press a name and the phone dials for me. So I don't do that. I still know my parents' phone number, 302-478-0843, because they've been in the same house since 1974. I know my sister's phone number because she's been in the same house since the early 1980s, 798-0388. I can tell you my grandparents' phone number from when they lived in Florida in the 1980s, but don't ask me my landline. I have to stop and think about that one. Although it helps that I have to punch it in at the CVS every time I go, or the Walgreens in order to get my discount stuff. That's probably the only reason I can remember it. So making sure that this stuff is written down so that if our technology fails us, we still have that information. And also thinking about what is the best way to communicate with the people on here. You know, I know like my parents, when I wrote down their contact information, I wrote down their landline as the primary cause because that's the one they're gonna answer. Doesn't matter if their cell phone is sitting right next to them and the cell phone rings and then the landline rings, they're gonna reach over and answer the landline first. My sister is exactly the opposite. Doesn't matter how many times the landline rings, she's gonna screen that, and until you start talking, she's not gonna pick it up, but the cell phone, she'll pick up right away. My nieces, I'm not even gonna call them, I'm gonna text because they never pick up the phone. I can be in the middle of a 20-minute text exchange with either one of them, call them in the middle of it, and they won't pick it up, even though I know they're holding the phone in their hand because I just got a reply text from them like 3 seconds ago. But that's just the way they choose to communicate. So thinking about how do the people or the resources on your list, what's the best way to communicate with them? For some, it may be an email address, not a phone number. So putting all that together. And the map, again, because we are beholden to this technology here, you know, I forget, just a couple days ago, somebody was talking about that they had, you know, looked on the Google Maps or something to get somewhere, and a bunch of us chuckled. We're like, really, Michelle? Right there, in your hand. You don't need to look up the Google Maps to get this stuff. It's all right there on your phone, because we're just so in tune to using that now. But again, if that's not functioning, then, you know, we need to do something else. Also, I don't know about you guys, but I'm pretty much a creature of habit. If I'm going from point A to point B, 99% of the time, I'm going the same way to get there. I may not even know that there's another way to get there. So if that route gets disrupted and my technology's not working and I need to get from my house to the shelter over here, then having that map in my kit is going to be helpful if I can remember how to read a map at this point in my life. Duct tape and plastic sheeting, that's for your at-home kit, and that is related to the shelter-in-place situation, which I'm going to talk more about in just a couple of minutes. We also need to make sure that we are thinking about the four-legged furry members of our family, or the ones with fins or feathers or whatever it is that they've got, scales, as well as the two-legged members, human members of our family, and thinking about all of this stuff that we're gonna need for them as well. It's a great organization in this area called Red Paw that does for pets what the Red Cross does for people. So I have a fire in my house. Red Cross comes, they set me all up with stuff, they're gonna put me in a hotel, the hotel won't take my cat. So Red Paw is also called if they know that a pet is involved, and they will foster my cat for me until I'm back in a situation where I can bring my cat back into wherever it is that I'm living. They will also take care of any medical expenses related to the disaster, and also whether I want it or not, if they're fostering the cat, he's gonna be spayed and neutered. While he's with them, and all of that is covered. They cover all of those costs. They've got really amazing relationships with a lot of people, including the Penn Veterinary Emergency Room, for doing things like oxygen tents and stuff like that for the pets. And if it comes to the point where I can't take my cat back for whatever reason, they have arrangements with different organizations that do adoption services for the pets. So it's a pretty cool organization. Shameless plug here, you can go to the Red Cross store and get your very own disaster kit. You can also take this handout that I'm gonna give you, which lists all of those items on it that we were just discussing. Go to the dollar store and put one of those kits together for, you know, probably under $30-$35 if you're getting the good stuff in there. It's very easy to do. So you got your, yes sir?
I was thinking, earplugs?
Huh?
You said it's just open.
Yeah. Probably not a bad idea. I have some in mind. And that's right, I was gonna follow up and I forgot to do that. And then, so that's what the recommended stuff is. Then there's the personalizing piece of the kit and taking care of that mental health side of things. So things like my kit, I've got earplugs in there. I have an extra set of contact lenses. I've got extra contact solution. I have an extra pair of glasses. Even though they're my old prescription, I don't know if I would see out of them very well at all. I've got an extra set of reading glasses. Got three novels in there, two Sudoku puzzle books, two crossword puzzle books, two decks of regular playing cards, two decks of pinochle playing cards. I'm not gonna be bored if I'm ever in a shelter situation. Of course, like, who am I kidding though? I'm a Red Crosser. Mm-hmm. I'm not gonna be bored if I'm in a shelter anyway. But making sure that you take care of that mental health side of things as well. Some people like to put pictures of family members or friends or, you know, just things that make them feel good in there as well. We recommend the kids, like, you know, get a, you know, not currently, but maybe in the past favorite toy kind of thing and throw that in your go bag so that you've got that comfort item. Throw familiar toys for the pet or a blanket that they like in their go kit as well if you have to evacuate to give them that comfort level. So you got your supplies together. What's the rest that you need to do in terms of making your plan? Well, the first thing we need to do is we need to sit down, we need to talk to everybody in the household so that everybody's on the same page. We're all going to have the same level of knowledge about how we're going to deal with any of these emergency events if they happen. And the first thing really that we need to talk about, so we know what we're dealing with, is thinking about what kinds of threats are present with relation to the area where we live. So, fire, far and away, the biggest threat, not only here in eastern Pennsylvania and the entire state of Pennsylvania, but the entire United States. About 92% of the responses that we get here in eastern Pennsylvania are home fires with people. So very high risk of fires. High risk of flooding in this area as well. Pennsylvania is one of the most flood-prone states in the United States. We get a lot of flooding in this area. Severe winter storms, we get a lot of those. Seems to me, and every time I do this presentation, I swear I'm gonna sit down, I'm gonna look this stuff up, and I did once and I couldn't find the data, but I didn't have a lot of time to look. It seems to me that for winter storms in this area, we go in cycles, where we'll go 2 or 3 years where we'll get slammed really hard, and then we'll go for 3 years or so where we won't get too much, and then we'll go for 2 or 3 more and we'll get slammed really hard. And there's an ebb and flow to the way that winter storms impact this area. You know, I don't know if I'm making that up in my head or if it's fact, but that's just what my experience tends to tell me. There was some folks in the public health disaster area at Drexel who did a pretty intensive study about 2 years ago and thinking about what kinds of threats could hit this area and the impact that they would have. The most dangerous threat in terms of effect over the largest percentage of the population was something like influenza pandemic for this area was the biggest impact. The natural disaster that would have the biggest impact on this area and was most likely was a really huge severe winter storm. So we definitely want to make sure that we're thinking about those things. Building collapse, we have a high incidence of those in this area. That's actually our number three response in eastern Pennsylvania after fires and floods is building collapses. Majority of those happen in Philadelphia, older city, very old infrastructure, a lot of abandoned buildings. So we have that happen quite a bit, but also places like Norristown and Wilkesboro, Scranton and Reading, we get quite a few building collapses in those areas as well. Terrorism, we're at an above average risk in this area, primarily directly in Philadelphia because of the historic nature of the city and that we have become more and more of a financial center in this area. So we've got a pretty high risk there. Also tied into the hazardous materials and transportation because of the airport and the train station and the port, we're also at higher risk to terrorism. And again, going to that hazardous materials and transportation, you think about going through southeastern Pennsylvania, we have the Schuylkill Expressway, we have I-95, we have the port in Philadelphia, we have the Northeast Airport, we have the Philadelphia International Airport, we've got rail lines going all over this area and other major highways as well. So we run a pretty above average risk for incidents related to those. Pandemic influenza, primarily because of how tightly packed we are in this area as far as population density is why our risk is so high for that. Average risk of hurricanes in this area, average risk of tornadoes. Yes, we do get tornadoes in Pennsylvania. All 50 states experience tornadoes. Radiological incidents, we've got an average risk. We do have 5 nuclear power plants that are close enough to us here in southeastern Pennsylvania, both in southeastern Pennsylvania and in the nearby regions, that they could have a significant impact on our area. And then we have a risk of earthquakes in this area as well, although it's low. Question?
Could you explain what iodine tablets do? Something.
You know what, it has been so long since anybody asked me about the iodine tablets that I actually forget, and I wouldn't want to give you incorrect information. It does have to do with helping with relation to the effect of radiation on you, but I don't remember the specifics. It potentially lowers the impact of radiation on your body, but I don't know. I can't remember the exact what you're supposed to take and how long it lasts and when you should take it and all that stuff, but it is directly related to the radiation situation. As I said, the earthquakes, low risk. We do experience those in all 50 states as well, just like tornadoes, not just California. In that area, we've got some pretty significant faults, both on the east coast of the United States here. There's a big one down in the Carolinas. Goes pretty close to Charleston. It's kind of a C-shaped fault down through that area. There's one up through New York State. There's a huge one that runs right down the Mississippi River in the center of the United States. And then of course we've got the big, the San Andreas and the other faults that are part of that, what they call the Circle of Fire, which goes all the way around the Pacific Ocean. But we do have those risks here. Also, earthquakes on this coast, smaller earthquakes will travel further because we are all sitting on bedrock here. So that earthquake that happened a few years back in Virginia that we felt the shaking of in this area up here, had that same earthquake happened in California, they would not have felt the shaking as far away as we did because the geology is different over there and the shock waves don't travel as far. As I talked about, sit fire, number one, disaster number one risk we have, so what do we need to do to be ready for that? Make sure you have working smoke alarms in your homes. Anybody know how many you should have smoke alarms in your house? Minimum of one per floor, and then ideally one in every sleeping area as well. And don't forget the basement and the attic count as floors in the house. Check them once a month, regardless of whether you have traditional 9-volt battery smoke alarms or whether you have the newer 10-year lithium battery smoke alarms. Still check them once a month. Give them a quick sweep with the vacuum to clear away any dust or debris or pet dander or stuff like that that may be in them that can inhibit their functionality. Okay. If you have the 9-volt smoke alarms, new batteries once a year. Check all of them once a month, new batteries for the 9-volts once a year, and every smoke alarm should be replaced once every 10 years. Doesn't matter whether it's a 9-volter, you keep putting new batteries in, or whether it's a 10-year lithium battery, which you can't take the battery out of most of those. They're sealed inside there, so after 10 years, you just get a whole new smoke alarm. Okay. Know your escape routes, preferably two ways out of each room in the house. Again, we're going to talk to everybody in the house about this. Have a meeting place outside your home, somewhere that everybody's going to know where they can go once they get outside. It should be in front of the house because that's where the responders are going to come, and you want to be able to tell them right away, yes, everybody's out of the house, or X and such is still inside. Here's where we think they are most likely to be. If you cannot get out of your home, since we're talking about that, close the door where you are, in the room where you are. Put a blanket or towel underneath the door if you can and have something to do that. Go over to the window, open the window, stay next to it. Yell help fire as loud as you can out the window. And if you've got something to wave, wave it out so that to draw attention to the firefighters. We recommend that you conduct home fire drills twice a year. One of those, would be ideal if you had at night, since that's when most fires happen in homes. The huge majority of fires happen between 11 p.m. and 6 a.m. So it makes sense that you should have a fire drill during that time period as well, so that people can get used to finding their way out of the house in the dark, since that's most likely what's going to happen. And know that once you are outside of the house, stay out. Don't go back inside for any reason.
What starts them usually?
What starts fires? That's a really good question. A lot of fires start in kitchens. What a lot of people think about, careless cooking. The thing about those fires, though, is that many of them stay contained in the kitchen when they happen. The majority of kitchen fires actually stay contained in the kitchen, so they are not as dangerous as other types of fires, even though they're one of the most common. A more dangerous type of fire is one that happens because of old electrical wiring or the overloading of an outlet by plugging too many things into it. One that can happen in the middle of the night. And most of those types of fires, which are the ones that are more likely to turn into fires that produce injury and death, those are the ones that typically happen in the evening, and a lot of those start in the living room. They start in a common room. Careless smoking is another major reason for fires. Those can sometimes start in the living rooms. People fall apart or fall asleep, they drop cigarettes down inside a sofa or something like that. It smolders for a period of time and then bursts into flame, or careless smoking while in bed is another one. But between the faulty electrical situation, careless smoking and careless cooking, and then kids playing with matches and lighters, unfortunately, is another one. You've pretty much covered just about all of the fires that happen in people's homes. So, once you talk about all of the events that might happen, putting together your plan, having an out-of-town contact, so that if something does happen and you're separated or you're away from home when something happens, identifying somebody outside of the immediate area to be able to, for everybody to check in with. My Aunt Suzanne down in Florida is our contact, so that if we can't get through to each other here, then she is the person that we will get in touch with. A lot of times, remember back, even not so very long ago, using a landline to call my grandparents down in Florida on Mother's Day or Christmas or something like that, you would get the beep, boop, boop, please try again later, all circuits are busy. Well, The exact opposite happens in disaster situations. It's local circuits that get jammed, and even cell phone signals that can get mashed up, and calling outside of the area is many times easier than trying to get in touch with somebody inside the local area. So that's why we recommend that out-of-state contact. Two places to meet after a disaster, again, fire or other sudden emergency in the home, right outside of the house. You are away from home, all the family members are not together. Identifying somewhere outside of your neighborhood where everybody can get together before making your way to wherever it is that that location is going to be, shelter, friends, family, house, whatever that is, wherever you're going to go. Learn some stuff, how and when to turn off utilities. Things like gas, you should never turn off unless you are instructed to do so by the gas company or by the authorities, because you can't turn the gas back on. The gas company has to come back out and do that. So if you're just doing it, everybody just does it because they feel like it, they're afraid, it could take a really long time to get your gas back on. Would not be a good situation. How and when to use a fire extinguisher. General rule of thumb is if the fire is any bigger than like an office-sized trash can, don't even try, just get out of the house. Don't even try. If you haven't been trained to use a fire extinguisher, don't try to use the fire extinguisher. A lot of fire companies will do trainings. We're coming up in October on National Fire Prevention Week. I think it's the 9th through the 15th this year. And many fire companies will have open houses. And one of the things that they'll do during that time period is fire extinguisher training. Some of them will do it outside of that time period as well. You can touch base with them and they'll do a fire extinguisher training, or they may schedule them on a regular basis. The other thing is, as far as fire extinguishers are concerned, 5 seconds. The fire's not out in 5 seconds, drop the fire extinguisher, get out of there because it's not going out. Okay. How and when to call for emergency help. In this area, we have 911. That's a pretty routine thing for us. What to do as far as what the emergency plans are for schools and your workplace. Always important information to know. I guess because of who we are as an organization, we have regular evacuation drills at the Red Cross, at our offices, at the Red Cross house at 40th and Powelton Streets where we have, to make sure that everybody knows what to do in situations. And then thinking about alternate routes of transportation if you're not able to use your car, something happens to your car. We had folks that we were a call center for Louisiana as a result of the floods, and people are calling saying, my car is under 6 feet of water. They had to rescue me in a boat to be able to, get that. So stuff like that happens. You can't use your vehicle. What are the other ways that you may be able to get to wherever it is you need to go in those situations? Make sure everybody in the household knows where your supplies are stored. We have 3 kits in our house, one for me, one for my husband, one for the cat. So we each have our own go bags. If something happens, we each grab a bag. Whoever gets to the cat's bag first grabs that. The other one grabs the cat, and boom, off we go. And they're in what we call the Harry Potter closet. It's the closet under the stairs in our dining room, so we know exactly where they are. We can grab them and go. Everybody needs to know the details of your plan, and also have a copy of the emergency contact information. So they've got that all the time. And then practicing. Just like the fire drills, it's important to practice your entire disaster drill. Very important. Sheltering in place is what we do if something happens, like a dangerous chemical release. You guys remember, I think it was about two and a half years ago now, there was a train that derailed in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Going over a little creek, the bridge broke, chemical got released, I can't remember what it was. I had friends who lived close to that area, and for about 2 hours afterwards, they were told to shelter in place. After 2 hours had passed, enough of the chemical had dissipated in the air that they were then told to evacuate because it was safe enough to get through the stuff, but it wasn't safe enough for them to stay in the area for long-term exposure to it. So they got out of there, and I think it was 3 days before they were able to go back to their home, if I remember correctly. So the sheltering in place is if something like that happens and you have to stay in your home for a period of time, this is what we're going to tell folks to do. You need to make sure that these items are in your at-home kit, the duct tape and plastic sheeting that we talked about, radio, battery operated with alternative power options, and then extra fresh batteries. To get to shelter in place, you want to think about an interior room without windows above ground level is the ideal situation. My house doesn't have one of those. Every room in my house has windows in it. So we utilize the second floor bathroom as our shelter in place room. Communication plan you want to talk about, and then if you do have to evacuate, which many of the shelter in place situations can turn into, then know what your evacuation route is going to be. So you're told to shelter in place by the local authorities. You want to start by closing and locking all the windows and exterior doors of the house, turn off the fans, heating systems, anything that's drawing air from outside of the home into the home. Close the fireplace dampers, get your kit, go to your shelter in place room, and then what you are going to do is seal all the cracks around the doors, vents, and windows utilizing that plastic sheeting and that duct tape, which we recommend you cut into pre-sized pieces based upon doors, windows, vents, etc. that are in that room. So I've got mine cut, and then they're all folded up in very little, you know, OCD squares, and then up here on each square is written what it's for. So I can look right at the top of the thing and say, okay, this is the one for the door. Boom, I pull it up, I put it over the door. And tape the corners of the plastic sheeting first, and then go around and seal the rest. Get that radio on, listen for updated reports and advice that you may have. And of course, if there is a life-threatening situation, and only a life-threatening situation, call 911 for assistance in that situation. So being informed, yes?
In that chemical situation, would a surgical mask have helped, or not really?
It probably would have, yeah. That's one of the optional things that we will talk about, recommending for folks to have in their disaster kits as well. Is having a surgical mask, and there's a, I want to say it's like a C90 mask or something like that. There's a letter and a number that's the recommended one, and gosh, I was just putting together a list for somebody, but like, I can't remember what that particular type of mask is, and bear with me for just a second. Something,
thank you.
ID leash.
Thank you.
All right. You're welcome. Take care, David. Thank you. No, it's not on this list either. But yeah, I mean, it's not a bad thing to have. Not only in like a chemical situation, but for cleaning up afterwards, if something is going on and you know there's dust and things around, you're cleaning up your home in a disaster situation. Not a bad thing to have at all. As far as being informed is concerned, some basic information, know what can happen. We've already talked about that tonight, how you can help being prepared and getting all that stuff together is what you can do. Identify how local authorities will notify you. Emergency broadcast system is gonna happen on just about every network, radio, TV station that we have around here. I'm gonna tell you to the official notification stations for radio in here in just a second, but just about anywhere is gonna be good. Learn what you can do to prepare. Again, we've done that this evening. And then share what you've learned because, you know, as you can see, not a lot of people come to presentations like this. Not a lot of people actively seek out information on how to be ready in case an emergency happens. So the more that you can do to help us spread the word, as much as I would love to talk to every person in Eastern Pennsylvania about this kind of stuff, I know that that's not a reality. So we ask that anybody who takes part in one of these presentations shares that information with other people to help others be prepared, because the more prepared each of us is, the better it is for our community as a whole, because the less likely it is that people are going to be injured, that they're going to need emergency assistance, that they'll be able to get through at least that first 72-hour period on their own or with minimal assistance from folks around them. Official radio stations for notifications, surprise, surprise, KYW is the AM station for this area. And then HYY, which is 90.9, the NPR station, is the official FM station. Not that everybody won't be getting the same information, but you can be sure that when your local, the county emergency managers disseminate information, it goes to these folks first. They're gonna have the quickest. Other ways that you can be informed and be prepared, take a CPR first aid AED course to be able to provide assistance for folks in emergency situations. We are constantly in need of blood. There's always a need for blood. I'm hoping that someday that won't be the case, you know, that eventually we're gonna have synthetic blood products and we won't need to rely on people to donate blood in order to be able to replace that. And that as surgeries get less and less invasive, the demand for blood is going down, but we still need some. Hoping that we won't have to do that for much longer then. And then of course, you can volunteer for the Red Cross, other organizations that are around that do phenomenal work with relation to disaster preparedness education, to responding to disasters, to helping people after disasters have occurred. There's lots of great things that folks can do. This is a phenomenal resource. It's called Ready Notify PA. You can go to this website and you can put an email or a phone number in and select to get email messages or text message notifications on different types of emergency events. And it's everything from traffic to major weather events. Be selective though when you're choosing. I have a professional colleague who's with the local Department of Homeland Security office. So on his cell phone, he has gone on to Ready Notify PA and selected absolutely everything. Mm-hmm. He says, there are some days when I get 500 or 600 text messages.
Oh,
yeah, because of everything that's going on. So yes, be selective, unless you have a really, really unlimited data plan. That could get you into trouble quickly, but that's a great resource. So those are our three actions that we recommend that everybody take in order to be better prepared for an emergency / disaster situation. If you have any questions, you can go to our website. That's our general phone number up there. We've got a Facebook page, we have a Twitter account, I just realized as I'm sitting here saying this that I left the stack of business cards that I had set aside to bring over here tonight still sitting on my desk. However, Mark does have my contact information, so if you've got any questions about anything that we've discussed tonight, please don't hesitate to shoot me an email or give me a call and leave me a voicemail if I'm not in the office. I'd be happy to get back to you on that stuff. If you are involved with any other community organizations and you think that they might be interested in a presentation like this one, I'm happy to come out and do that as well. We'll do it during the day, we'll do it in the evening, we'll do it on the weekends. We want to get that information out there, make sure everybody's prepared. Okay, so questions, thoughts, comments? Yes?
Sometimes here on the radio, this like company that sells like these kits, you know, non-perishable food that's good for, I don't know, a year or two or something.
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard much about it? It's even worth to, I don't know.
My experience with a lot of that long-term shelf stuff, and a lot of it has to do with, you know, kits that I've ordered at the Red Cross and that we've given out, and the stuff that comes in those kits that I was talking about is that, you know, perfectly good stuff, perfectly nutritious, not the most delicious thing in the entire world. I know that the stuff that comes in the Red Cross stuff, it's like eating, you know, like press board. It is just, mm-hmm. it is not very enjoyable at all. So one of the other programs that I do is a senior disaster preparedness program. It's 3 sessions long. If they attend all 3 sessions, we actually give them a starter disaster kit at the end of the sessions. So I'm going around trying to find a somewhat nutritious food of some kind to put into this kit. The other thing about a lot of those emergency rations is that the sodium level is pretty high in those. So you have to look at stuff like that when you're thinking about doing that and making sure that it's, there's reasons why stuff like that has really long shelf lives, and a lot of it is because of what's in there. So you need to be aware of that. So what we ended up doing for the seniors, at the suggestion of a geriatric nurse who was working with us on this program, was we put Clif Bars in there. They've got a reasonably long shelf life, not tremendously, but it's like 4-5 months that those will last. They're reasonably nutritious. You know, we have to be careful about allergies and let them know what's going on with them, but that's gonna be the case with any food, because it just seemed like all of that pre-prepared stuff that we were looking at was either prohibitively expensive, or it was either high in sodium or in some other way not a very healthy option. So we decided to go with the Clif Bars instead. So yeah, just got to do your homework on it. You know, take a look at it, see what's in there, and decide whether or not it's going to be good stuff for you. But very good question. Gonna give everybody 2 handouts here.
Okay. How long does water last? Have 3 gallons of water at least?
So, most bottled water is gonna have an expiration date on the bottle somewhere. If it comes in a case, sometimes it won't be on the bottle itself. It'll be either on the plastic wrapping or on the cardboard tray that it is in. Typically, you're probably looking at like 3 years, I think is the average I'm looking at. I haven't seen anything that says this is the standard recommendation or anything like that. I haven't found anything on that in the research that I've done.
Switch it out every year, like so it's still water.
Yeah, I mean, just, you know, now if it is water that you're bottling yourself, you're taking the milk jug and rinsing out, cleaning out the milk jug and then putting tap water in there, every 3 months, change that stuff out. Now, it's not as though in either situation, if you drink the water in, you know, one of these bottles, you know, even a month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months after the expiration date on here, that you're going to die some instantaneous horrible death. But it could make sure for an uncomfortable situation for you for a little while if you get my drift. Okay. The things that are of concern are, over a period of time, the plastic will leach into the water, and that can make it very upsetting for you. Again, it's not, you know, a death threat or anything like that, but it can be harmful for you. And the other thing is that no matter how filtered or springy or whatever the water is, there are microorganisms in this water, and they continue to reproduce and reproduce and reproduce. And over time, they may get to a point where, you know, there's so many of them in there that you go to drink the water and, you know, they have a ball in your lower intestinal tract and you don't want that situation going on. So that's what you have to keep. I just check the expiration dates of everything every 6 months, you know, that I put in there. And anything that's coming up close, I just deal with it right then. I put new stuff in there so I don't have to worry about it. Good question though. So the 2 pieces of paper that I gave you, the red one is the information that we talked about tonight. Mm-hmm. Recommended items for your kit, including some pet stuff as well, the steps for putting your plan together, and then the important information that you need to gather as far as your plan is concerned. It's English on one side, Spanish on the other. You can go to redcross.org, and if you type in disaster tip sheets in the search thing, it'll take you to a library of these. There's this red one. There's this that is fire safety, since it is the biggest risk that we have. You can do that, and it goes through 3 different areas on here as well. Some prevention stuff on here, since fires are the only disaster that we can actually take steps to prevent. So that information is on here. There's also a hurricane, there's a flood, there's a thunderstorm. There's flooding, there's returning home after a hurricane or a flood, there's a pet safety one, there's a winter storm, there's a heat wave, and most of them come in at least, I think it's like 7 or 8 languages. There's English, there's Spanish, there's French, there is Cantonese, there's Mandarin, there's Arabic, there is Vietnamese, there's Russian, and I think there's at least one more, but they come in multiple languages on there. So it's on the Red Cross Disaster Library. It's basically what the resource is called. But if you just Google tip sheets on the Red Cross website, it'll bring you up to that link. there. And you can download those, they're PDFs that you can download and print out as many copies as you want.
In the shelters, those gymnasiums, have you seen anybody like put a duffel bag or whatever container that works better for them rather than not always having stuff all over the place?
Duffel bags are great. I've seen people who have taken like the Rubbermaid containers. So it's like, you know, big, look like big Tupperware container kind of things and utilize those. Like I said, we've got knapsacks. You know, each one of us has a knapsack that we put the stuff into. But, you know, it's whatever works for you. Everybody's gonna have, you know, a different feeling about what works best for them. And again, what you're gonna have is also gonna be related to how much can you comfortably transport. You know, because I know that each of us is taking our bag and then one of us is gonna have the cat's bag and one of us is gonna have the cat, I went a little light on the changes of clothes and stuff in the bags, because I know that that's gonna be, you know, we don't wanna get ourselves exhausted in transporting that stuff. So just thinking about how big is it, what are you gonna be able to handle, what are you gonna be comfortable with? Okay. Good question though. Any other questions or thoughts you guys have? Well, thank you very much for coming tonight. I really do appreciate it. Thank you for your patience and letting me go well over the time that I was allotted this evening. Mark, I'm gonna leave these with you so you can put them on the resource table for the library so anybody else that comes by is more than welcome to pick these up. This is not copywritten material, so if you guys wanna make copies of these and share them with other people, please feel free to do so. Like I said, the more information that gets out there, the more people know, the more that they do to help themselves be ready, the better it is for all of us. So we're gonna get that information.
So in this area, or any area, are there designated like high schools? Like would it be Phoenixville or Great Valley? Either, I mean, or is it both, or how is it?
Yes, there are high schools that we ahead of time identify and go to and speak to and have agreements with to open shelters in there. However, we do not announce where those high schools are, and we don't announce that we are opening shelters until the staff is there and ready to be open. Because we don't want people going and sitting and waiting outside of an unopened shelter and possibly placing themselves in danger in order to do so. Also, the thing about shelters with the American Red Cross is we don't open them on our own or at our volition. We can only open shelters and operate shelters at the request of the local emergency management organization. So in Pennsylvania, the county emergency management organizations are the ones who dictate to us when and where we will open shelters. Now, a lot of times, you know, we know something is coming, a big storm is coming, we know that there's gonna be flooding. We've got a pretty good idea about where that flooding is gonna happen. Even before they direct us, we're pretty sure where those shelters are going to be open. But we will have conversations ahead of time. You know, big storm is on the way. We'll have a conversation. Here's where we're most likely to go. So we will pre-position our supplies close to those shelters or right outside those shelters so that when the emergency management says go, our stuff is right there and ready to go. One of the challenging aspects for us in terms of Louisiana was that wasn't like a hurricane. Nobody saw that coming in terms of it hanging around and causing that much flooding. Yeah, we all knew that there was a big storm that was gonna hit Louisiana. Nobody realized it was gonna stall over top of them and rain and rain and rain and cause as much flooding as it did. So we weren't able to pre-position a lot of stuff the way we would have, you know, like we did before Katrina and we did before Sandy and situations like that. You know, we were ready to go for those. This was kind of an out of the blue situation, so we were playing catch up from the get-go with the Louisiana floods because it was just such a freak kind of occurrence the way that it happened. But usually big stuff, we're able to have things ready to go in those positions. But again, we're not gonna let anybody know where the shelters are gonna be and announce that the shelters are gonna be open until our teams are in place and they're ready to open those doors and let people come in and be in a safe place. Good question though.
Added poncho.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. All right. Well, thank you again, guys, very much. Appreciate you being here.
Yeah.
Take care.